الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Praise be to Allah سبحانه وتعالى and praise be upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this beautiful gathering that we get together for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to know more about Allah azza wa jal and to understand the deen of Allah azza wa jal better. And we'll continue with the book of Riyadh al-Salihin, which is a book that's been compiled by one of the great scholars in Islam, Imam al-Nawawi. He compiled this book with different ahadith narrations of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he put them in different chapters. He categorized them in different chapters, speaking about your everyday life as a Muslim. What do you need to know as a Muslim? And tonight, inshaAllah, in the 57th chapter, Babu Qana'ati wal Afafi wal Iqtisadi fil Ma'isha, contentment and self-esteem, and avoidance of unnecessary begging of people. So inshallah tonight's topic or lecture, we'll be addressing as a quality of a believer. What's your quality? What's your trait as a Muslim? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be the best of people on the face of this earth. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make sure that people are the best. The believers are the best, not average, but the best. In the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, وَعِلْتُمْ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to complete and perfect the noble manners. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anticipates and expects from you not to be just an average person in society, but to be the best in society. To be the best in society. That's what Islam is about. You're a Muslim, you're a believer, you must be the best in society. You must be the best of people when it comes to the soil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. And no moving living creature is there on earth, but its provision is due from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is being provided by Allah azza wa jal. Everyone is being sustained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone is being sustained by Allah azza wa jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ رِزْقًا وَمَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the Holy Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only created the jinn and ins. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the jinn and the ins. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Musa make mention of the jinn, not only the ins? And the ins are human beings, mankind. So you've got the jinn and then you've got the human beings. Both jinn and human beings are responsible in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Human beings and jinn are responsible before Allah Azza wa Jal. We are all held responsible before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have this thing called responsibility, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from us his worship. In return, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold us responsible. From the many, many creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are two creations of Allah Azza wa Jal, which are held responsible by Allah Azza wa Jal hereafter. Those two creations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold responsible in the hereafter are the human beings and the jinn. Angels are not held responsible by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they never disobey Allah azza wa jal. Animals are not held responsible by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they're not given an intellect for them to make a decision or a choice. But you as a human being, or as a jinn, so you as a human being or the jinn, both are held responsible Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands and orders that they comply and abide by the laws or the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and return Allah azza wa jal will hold them responsible in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the jinn before he created the ins. Allah created the jinn before he created mankind. Now jinn, in English they call them spirits, they call them ghosts, they call them souls, whatever you want to call them. Okay, at the end of the day they're jinn, even in English they call them jinn. Okay, there's different names of the call and refer to them. The most common ones are either jinn or spirits or ghosts. Okay, really some people might refer to them as souls because the meaning of soul is wrong. But the jinn or ins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created both, and Allah azza wa jalla says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I only created the jinn and I only created the human beings for the sake of my worship. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ. I don't ask them to sustain or to provide in a provision. I don't want from them to have faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't seek anything from the human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't seek anything from the jinn. It is the human beings and the jinn who seek something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek everything from Allah azza wa jalla. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need anything from mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need anything from jinnkind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need anything from anyone. But everyone needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ascribes to himself the attribute of As-Samad. We just recited from Allah Ahad. Allahu As-Samad. What does As-Samad mean? Everyone asks Allah and Allah doesn't ask anyone. Everyone needs Allah and Allah doesn't need anyone. Everyone resorts to Allah and Allah doesn't resort to anyone. So وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ. I then ask from them to feed or to sustain. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, the first hadith in this chapter, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ليس الغني عن كثرة العرض ولكن الغني غني النفس. In this hadith, the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم says that the true rich person is not the one with a lot of wealth. The true rich person is not the one with a lot of wealth. Now, in the literal form, when you say someone is rich, in a literal form, when he says someone is rich, the first thing that crosses your mind is someone that has a lot of money, abundance of money. He's rich, he's got a lot of money. But then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the true rich person is the one, the self-sufficient. Ghaniyun nafs. Okay. Self-sufficient, what does it mean, ghaniyun nafs? Self-sufficient. It doesn't mean someone who is just independent. It doesn't mean someone who just depends on himself, he doesn't ask anyone for money, doesn't ask anyone for help, doesn't ask anyone for assistance, guys, and business guys, and health guys, and this and that. Self-sufficient here means that someone doesn't ask anyone for anything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Self-sufficient here, in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refers to as ghaniyun nafs, the true rich person. The true rich person. In the Sahab Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the true rich person, in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes mention in this hadith, is the one that doesn't ask anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He could be poor. He could be poor. So not necessarily to be someone with a lot of wealth that he owns his own business and his guys and his house and his guys and car and doesn't ask anyone for money. Like, he could be poor. He could be working for someone. He could be someone renting. He could be someone doesn't even have enough money to bring bread and butter. He doesn't have enough money for ends that he made. Or he doesn't have enough money for to buy other things that other people have. So he's not necessarily someone that's got everything or ends made. He is someone that is rich within himself. He's got this self-esteem that he doesn't ask anyone for anything. So he's got the integrity. He's got the dignity that he doesn't need to ask anyone for anything. That's ghaniyun nafs. Because you've got people who are rich, but they still decide to continue asking for other things. And not do anything for them to acquire, achieve their objective. But ghaniyun nafs here is someone that's dependent on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't ask anyone for anything. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taught the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum the concept of depending on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum really understood the concept of depending on Allah azza wa jal. Depending and relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means they ask Allah azza wa jal for everything. Everything that you need in life, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost. Then you start resorting to the creation of Allah azza wa jal. So the first one that you resort to, in which you ask, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then everyone else comes later. Our biggest problem is that we'll ask everyone before we ask Allah, and then we'll find everything, or everyone not responding, that's when we'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we'll find that all roads and all paths are shut, and there is no hope. We're getting that from this person and that person, that's when we resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah azza wa ta'ala. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says here, ليس الغني أو ليس الغني عن كثرة العرض ولكن الغني غني النفس. That the true rich person is not the one that has a lot of wealth, not the one that has a lot of money, not the one that can
bought and purchased and houses and cars to the end of it and has his own business. But the true rich person is the one that's self-sufficient, that only depends on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and only asks Allah azza wa ta'ala. Someone said that during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a pledge from a number of companions that if they were ever to ask anyone, they only ask Allah azza wa ta'ala. If they were ever to ask anyone, they only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That some of them will need salt or sugar. And they will not even ask anyone besides Allah azza wa ta'ala. They pray to look after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah azza wa ta'ala for salt or sugar. Even though they are very trivial things, very small things, they're not big things. What's salt and sugar? You'll ask anyone for salt and sugar. And it's not like something that's going to undermine from your respect if you're going to ask anyone for salt and sugar. Especially talking about an environment of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, an environment of companions, a society of righteous people. So you're going to ask anyone for salt and sugar, no one's going to look down at you. But this Sahaba decided that they'll only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they are so depending on Allah azza wa ta'ala. They only rely on Allah azza wa ta'ala. In the following hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمْ وَرَزَقَ كَفَافًا وَقَنَّعَهُ اللَّهُ بِمَا أَتَى. It is those who are successful, those who embrace Islam, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمْ وَرُزِقَ كَفَافًا وَرُزِقَ كَفَافًا. And they will be provided with sustenance which is sufficient for their needs. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَقَنَّعَهُ اللَّهُ بِمَا أَتَى. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them contentment in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sustained. My brothers and my sisters, contentment is a great honor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the believers. To be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you. Because if you're not content, then you've got a big issue. You've got a massive issue. Is a great ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you if you have it. What contentment? That you are satisfied. You are satisfied. You are happy and pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you. So you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything they have given you. That's contentment. Because you could be someone who only earns $10 a day and you are so content a lot more than someone who earns $10 a day. What's the difference? Alhamdulillah, I am pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me today. As opposed to someone who gets and earns millions of dollars and they're not content. They're still fine and they're still seeing themselves, oh, I need more. I'm not happy with what I have. Who is more richer? Is it the one that earns $10 or $100 a day and is content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him? Or the one that gets $100,000 a day and is not content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him? I assure you, the one that earns $10 a day and is content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him is a lot more richer. In reality, he's a lot more richer within himself than the one that earns $100,000 a day. For that, Imam Shafi'i, he says, Al-qana'atu kanzun la yakna. That being content is a great treasure from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will never ever end. It will never ever end. Just to be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you. At the end of the day, the one that has divided the sustenance and the provision is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that favored people over others when it comes to provision. We have favored some of you over others when it comes to provision. Some Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given them a lot more provision than others. And others Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given them less provision than others. Some Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given them millions of dollars. And others Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given them a few dollars. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that has decreed upon this person to be rich and upon this person to be poor. Or upon this person to be affluent. Or upon this person to be very rich. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that favored people over others. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see from you is contentment. Because if you've got millions of dollars and you're content, you're not rich, you're poor. And you'll continue to live poor. But if you earn a small amount of money, or you earn a small amount give contentment, you are a lot more richer than anyone else that has a lot more money. Because a lot of money, my brothers and my sisters, does not bring you happiness. This is the biggest problem that we've got in our life. We as human beings, we always connect happiness to money. Your connection of that is wrong. Happiness doesn't come through money. Money is never going to bring you, it's never going to bring you happiness. What's really going to bring you happiness is number one, your piety, and number two, contentment. Our equation is always wrong when it comes to that. We always connect happiness to money. You've got money, you're happy. Because if you've got money, you're going to buy a beautiful car, a big house, you're going to buy all the things that you want. And let us say you didn't buy everything. Did that bring you happiness? Go and speak to those who are rich. A lot of people that got everything, but they're not happy. Because there's no contentment and there's no piety. You have piety and contentment, you're happy. So disconnect that from this. Don't always bring the two together. Don't connect the two together. That if you've got money, that means you're going to be happy. You're wrong. A lot of the times you'll have money, but you're not happy. A lot of the times you don't have money, and you're happy. So money doesn't purchase happiness. What really purchases happiness is your pleasure and your pleasing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The pleasure of Allah azza wa jalla and your pleasing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that will give you and acquire you happiness. وَقَدَّعَ اللَّهُ بِمَا أَتَى. Indeed, those that will succeed, those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them contentment of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. If you are content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, then you are really happy. If you are content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, then you are really pleased in life. Qana'ah, contentment. That means you are happy and pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided to you. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for you. And that's one of the things that you see from the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the illustration of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the teachings of the Prophet alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given a lot of choices. He was given the choice between being a prophet and a king, and a prophet just a servant of Allah azza wa jalla. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose to be a prophet and a servant. Another choice that the Prophet, another offer that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which Jibreel alayhi salam comes down to the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam, saying to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Oh Muhammad, if you want the entire valley of Mecca to be gold, we'll grant it to you." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "No. I'd rather eat one day and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the food that He has provided me, and starve one day and have patience for the sake of Allah azza wa jalla." That's what you call contentment. It's not just about being cashed up. It's not about having a lot of money. It's not about seeing a number of digits in your bank account. It's about you being content. Contentment, my brothers and my sisters, is the key to happiness. Subhanallah, when you're content, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you satisfaction in your heart. In one hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Whoever wakes up every morning, their main concern is the akhirah. Their main concern is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him satisfaction in his heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this dunya run to them. Allah will give you satisfaction, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this dunya run to you. You'll have control of this dunya. And the third thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you control over your affairs. You'll control your affairs, you'll control yourself, you'll control your family, you'll control your business, you'll control all your affairs. Which means, not you dictate, it means that you have control of your affairs. You've got control of what's happening in your life. But those who wake up in the morning, their main concern is the dunya. Their main concern is this dunya, this world. And how can they acquire more money and earn more money? And all they care about is money, 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 money. And all they think about is money, money, money. And all they dream about is money, money, money. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring poverty right in between his eyes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put poverty in his heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will divide, will make him lose control of his affairs. Has no control over his affairs. Has no control over himself, has no control over his family, has got no control over his wealth, has got no control over his household, has got no control over his business. And subhanAllah, you see that. It's not like we're talking about something that it might happen. It is happening, you see it. I see a lot of people, I mix with a lot of people, I mix with a lot of people, I sell wealthy. And I'm telling you, a lot of those people are not happy. You, the one that probably earns a small fraction of what they earn, you're not happy even there. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you satisfaction. And satisfaction came? Satisfaction came because of your contentment. Be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, and Allah azza wa jalla will give you more. Be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided to you, and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you. And you look into the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see that character of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, اليد العليا خير من اليد السفلى وابدأ بمن تعود وخير الصدقة من ما كان على ظهر غنى ومن يستعفف يعفه الله ومن يستغني يغنه الله. The upper hand is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the lower hand, which means for you to earn your own income and not ask people, it is a lot more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you going around begging. When you're not content, my brother and my sister, you start begging. And let me say something to you. Beggars are not necessarily to be poor. You have rich beggars. They're not content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. So they are rich, but they're beggars. Because there's no contentment and satisfaction in their life. So they're willing to beg. They are willing to take their hands out and ask people for money. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that the upper hand is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the lower hand. For you to be self-sufficient, for you to be content and not ask others, it is a lot more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than those who ask others. It is a lot more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than those who go and ask others. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, start with those who are under your care. Start with those who are under your responsibility. The closer people to you, you have more of a responsibility over them than those who are far away from you. Which means, if it's a choice between you giving a donation to someone who's close to you and someone who's far away from you, then you give the donation to the one who's close to you and need of it than those who's far away from you. If it's a choice between spending on someone who's far away from you and someone who's close to you, then it's a choice that you should be spending on the one that's close to you. Because they're under your care, they're under your responsibility. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the best of sadaqah, the best of charity, is a charity that you give when you are wealthy. And you know, when you're wealthy, when you've got a lot more money, it's a lot more harder for you to donate for the sake of Allah than those that are not wealthy. Why? Because when you've got, for example, 100 bucks, giving up $50 is not hard. That's 50% of your wealth. But when you've got 100 million, you're not going to give 50 million. See the difference? You've got 100 bucks. What about 100 bucks? You know what? $50 for the sake of Allah, I'll give it. 50% of my wealth. But if you've got a meal, for example, you're not going to give 50%. I'm telling you, you're not going to give 50%. So, see the difference? Someone who's poor is willing to sacrifice a big portion of his wealth than someone who's rich. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that a charity, the best of charities, is a charity that you give when you are rich. And you give more. Because against your will, it's a lot more harder for you to give a bigger percentage of your wealth when you're rich than when you're poor. I've got 10 bucks, you know what? I'll give $8 out of the 10. Alhamdulillah. I'll stand with $2. You know what? I'll give the 10 bucks to you. Might as well. You'll give up all your wealth. But when you're wealthy and you've got a lot of money, it becomes a big struggle for you to give a big percentage. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, and whoever wishes to abstain away from begging, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him wealth. Don't ask. Don't beg. And when we say begging, we just came back from Hajj. We're not referring to those people come to your face
في سبيل الله مسكين يتيم give me that. That's one form of begging, and that's one of the ugliest forms of begging. But we're talking about even asking people for money. Asking people for money. It's not haram for you to ask someone for money, and it's not even haram for you to beg. But it's ugly. It's not a good character. And if you're in debt, or you're in desperate and dire need of help and support, and you go and ask someone for money, or ask for someone for a loan, okay, it's not haram. But it's not a good look. It does lower your integrity. It does lower your respect. And that's why people don't like to ask for money. It's not a good character in Islam that you're going to ask people for money. Especially when you ask people to give you money, not to loan you money. Asking someone for a loan is a lot more easier than asking someone for money. It's like, you know what, please give me 100 bucks, you know. But when you say to someone, look, lend me 100 bucks, it's a lot more easy. And it's a lot more rewarding for you to lend someone money than lending money. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on the journey of Isra' al-Mi'raj, he saw someone written in the paradise. One reward for the one that donates, and two rewards for the one that gives a loan. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, why is it that one reward for the one that donates and two rewards for the one that gives a loan? So Jibreel alayhi salam said to him, because the one that asks for money, he could be asking when he's not in need of it. But when someone asks for a loan, you only ask for a loan when you're in need of it. You only ask for a loan when you're in need of it. But you've got people that ask for money and they're not in need of it. And for your information, you've got a lot of beggars out there. You know, there's beggars on the street. Feels the reach. So we don't have them in Australia, but overseas, you can't read about them. Some of them, they'll buy us all, don't worry. Feels the reach. But subhanAllah, just became a custom. It became a habit in their lives for them to be. Low wives. I'm sorry to say, it's a low wife. Or a low integrity of wife. It's not haram to beg. And it's haram for you to look down at the beggars. And when I say a low wife, I'm not here looking down at them. I'm just saying their standard of wife is low. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't want that attitude. If someone gets a bed, they get in a bed. But it's not a good character. It's not a good character. It's not something that Islam is encouraging for. Islam doesn't want to see beggars. Islam doesn't want to see people who are asking for money. And you know, my brothers and my sisters, if 50% of the Muslim world pay their zakat, you have now poor people on the face of this earth. During the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, which was a pinnacle time of Islam, people were going around carrying bags of gold looking for someone to take a money off them, zakat. They are carrying bags of gold, zakat money, seeking someone to come and take it, looking for someone to take it, there's no one there to take it. Why? Because during this time, the majority of Muslims were paying their zakat, everyone became rich. There were no beggars. There were no poor people anymore. So you have someone carrying a bag of gold, which is a zakat, looking for someone to take it, no one's accepting it. And right now, my brothers and sisters in Islam, not necessarily 100% of the Muslim world pay their zakat. 50%, and there's some calculations that say, if 20% of Muslims around the world, and we are talking about those in which zakat becomes obligatory upon them, if 20% of those who are eligible to pay their zakat and mandatory upon them to pay their zakat, pay their zakat, there'll be not even one Muslim, one poor Muslim in the Muslim world. 20% and I've read some studies and findings. If 20% of the rich Muslims around the world pay their zakat, there will be not even one poor Muslim in this world. SubhanAllah, the Islamic system is a great system. Now, what's zakat? 2.5%. 2.5%. What's 2.5%? Nothing. So, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in this hadith, وَمَنْ يَسْتَغْلِي يُغْنِهِ اللَّهِ. And whoever seeks self-sufficiency, whoever is self-sufficient and doesn't ask people for money, doesn't beg for money, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him rich.
You can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will give you a return. But if you want to ask the creation of Allah, then depend on them and wait for them to respond back to you. Wait for them to get back to you. They, someone who is self-sufficient, someone with integrity, someone with dignity, someone with respect. And the reality is when you see someone asking maybe for money for themselves, you lose respect to them. That's a reality. When someone gathers around and asks money, he's not the top person that you want to hang out with, or he's not the top person that you want to affiliate yourself to. Yes, he gave it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you shouldn't be looking down at him or degrading them. As the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, give the beggar even if he comes on a mount, even if he comes on the back of a horse. So in other words, even if someone's driving a car and asks for money, give him. If the Allah is seeing that's between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. And the beggar don't reprimand, don't push around. Don't be brutal or cruel towards the beggar. But at the end of the day, begging is not a good thing. Even though it's permitted for someone to do, and it's not haram for someone to do, but it's not something that's encouraged. And it's not something that Sharia would like to see, you know, I'm begging. And you know, my brothers and my sisters, especially in Western world, I've been to, like, you know, alhamdulillah, I haven't seen that scene here yet, but I've been to other countries, like in the UK, that it's like one of the worst scenes when you see on the hajj, a sister that's wearing the hijab, walking around and asking money, especially from non-Muslims. Or sitting in one of the stations and asking for money, and she's wearing the hijab. Wallahi, you feel like not only that she's, or I don't want to say the word degrading Islam, but degrading Islam with it too. It's an ugly scene. It's a very ugly scene to see a Muslim sister wearing the hijab going around asking for money. Or you see someone, for example, a abaya going around and asking for money. It's an ugly scene. Islam is about integrity, about respect. And obviously when someone begs, it's not a good quality for someone to beg. What Islam wants to see, Islam would want to see, believers to be strong. The upper hand, as the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions, someone who's independent, someone who's self-sufficient, someone that doesn't need to ask anyone, and they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first and foremost that he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then we'll ask someone else. Someone who's strong. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَحْرَسْ عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكَ. Always seek for something that benefits you. Have the upper hand. Be rich, be strong. Be respectful. Show Islam. Portray Islam. Let people know that alhamdulillah, we've got successful Muslims out there. Successful business Muslims out there. Successful intellectual Muslims out there. Successful Muslims in whatever field or scope they are in. We need to see that success there. That's the image that we want to have. Not someone who's going to beg. Not someone who's going around and asking. And be someone who is self-sufficient and someone who has contentment. Have that contentment in your life. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that Allah has given you. The more that you thank Allah, the more that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got to give you. The more that you are content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, the more you feel more self-satisfaction and sufficiency in your life, the more happiness that you find in your life. Don't always look at someone else and say, oh, okay, he's got a million, I've got $500,000, I want to have 2 million. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Allah has given you. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves his servant, that he eats one bite from my food and he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. And he drinks one sip and he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. Thank Allah Azza wa Jalla. Be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that you eat, everything that you drink, and everything that you have, and every dollar they have in your pocket. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not necessarily, oh, you know what? Why is he giving more than me? Alhamdulillah, that's what Allah has written upon you. And yes, rich people might have advantages early in this dunya. Rich people might have advantages over poor people in this dunya, but in the hereafter, keep that in mind. Poor people have advantages over the rich people. In Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in one hadith that the poor people will enter the Jannah before the rich people by 500 years in the hereafter. Look at the advantage that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the poor people. So a rich man, a rich woman, a rich family might have an advantage in this dunya, but in the hereafter, they don't have an advantage, they have a disadvantage. Poor believers will enter the Jannah before they reach the day after. And there's a duration of about 500 days in between. So how long are you living in this dunya? Maximum 80 to 100 days. But in the hereafter, you're going to be entering the Jannah before they reach the day before 500 days. Do your calculations. I'm not saying that you need poor. Don't get me wrong. Don't say, alhamdulillah, inshallah, you know what? I'm going to stick to being poor. No, be rich. But be a strong, rich Muslim. Be a strong, rich Muslim. That's what Islam wants to see from you. And we've spoken about this topic before. There's nothing wrong about you being rich. Sulaiman alayhi salam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's a prophet and messenger. He's from the greatest people that ever tread this earth. He's from the greatest people to ever walk this face of this earth. From the greatest people that ever exist on the face of this earth, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, give me a kingdom that you'll never ever give to anyone before me or after me. That you'll never give to anyone before me, and you'll never give to anyone after me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him the most wealthiest, richest man to ever exist on the face of this earth is Sulaiman alayhi salam. And he was a prophet and messenger. There's nothing wrong with you being rich and wealthy. As long as that you please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as you are self-sufficient, you are content, and as long as you give rights of this wealth back to Allah azza wa jalla. And that's a topic that we've covered before this. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants to see the believers to be the best of people in society, and for you to be the one with the upper hand, not the lower hand. For you to have that respect. But again, as mentioned, brothers and sisters, it's not just about having that wealth, it's about what you're going to do with this wealth. I mentioned this to you before so many times. This wealth that you have in your hands, it could be either a ni'mah or a ni'mah. It could be a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or it could be a curse. It could be a curse. There's a story about a khalifa. One of the khulafa, back then we're talking about the khulafa al-Abbasin, they were the most powerful people on the face of this earth, and they were the most wealthiest of people on the face of this earth. One of the sons of the khalifa, he used to live in his palace, yeah? He used to live in his dad's palace. And he felt, with everything that surrounds him, all the wealth that he has, he felt there was something missing in his life. So every morning, he'll wake up to the voice of someone, praise Allah, the prison, outside the fortress of his palace. So he'll see someone every single morning, praise Allah, the prison, and the palace used to be on the shore of a river. So the palace used to be situated on the shore of a river. So every morning he'll wake up to the voice of someone reading the Quran again, with Salat al Fajr, and he starts to monitor this person. So this person every single day comes, prays Salat al Fajr. He works as someone carrying things for people who are coming on the shore of the river. Like, you know what we call it like that, just someone who carries things and someone who just moves things, like a removalist if you want to call them. He stays from Fajr all the way to Dhuhr and then goes every single day. So this son of the Khalifa, every single day is monitoring this person, praying Salat al-Fajr, staying there till Dhuhr, helping out here and there, removing things from here and there, working for this person and that person, and then comes the final day. So he wanted to know, he was like curious to know, what's this person, what does he do, what's his lifestyle? So one day he summoned him, he sent one of the soldiers in his palace and he summoned him. And we're talking about a young teenager, like the son of the Khalifa was a young teenager. So he summoned this man that every day reads the Quran again for Salat al-Fajr. He wakes up to his voice, sings and working the whole day until Salat al-Dhuhr at midday, and then he goes home, and then the following day he starts all over again. So he summoned this man, he came to the Khalifa's palace, and the son of the Khalifa asked him, what's your story? What do you exactly do? Every single day you've got the same custom, you've got the same routine. He said, every day I come and pray Salat al-Fajr, I'd work, I earn an income, I go back, and look after my mother and my sister. That's his life. Looking after his mother and sister, every single day. Looking after his mother and sister, works from Fajr to Dhuhr, earns a bit of income, takes it back home, feeds his mom, takes care of his sister, and that's it, that's his lifestyle. And he asked him, are you happy? He said, alhamdulillah, I'm happy. So the son of the Khalifa, he was very enthusiastic to know exactly what. He was very curious to know exactly what's the lifestyle of this person. So he asked him, are you happy? He said, I'm happy. So he asked him, would you like to live in a palace? He said, no, no, I'm happy to live where I am. So that triggered something in his mind. So what did he do? He came to his house.
He escaped his palace, which house? What the house has got a palace? He escaped the palace of his father. Where did he go? He went and lived and worked in a bakery. He went and lived and worked in a bakery, and his father's looking for him. And the young fellow just, the poor kid just disappeared. So he was working in a bakery for someone that is a baker. He didn't last for too long, working as a laborer in a bakery, in the hot bakery, to the end of it. You know, it's not an easy job. But you know, it's a slave labor if you want to call it. Years went past, and the son of the Khalifa just working as a laborer and living in the bakery. And the baker, the owner of the business, didn't even know the son of the Khalifa. He has no idea that this person was working for him. He's the son of the most powerful man on the face of this earth. So years to come, the son of the Khalifa became very ill and passed away. When he was on his deathbed, he told his boss, the one that he was working for, he told him, listen, go and inform my father that I lived the last few years of my life the most happiest person on the face of this earth. So I asked him, is he dead? He said, my father's the Khalifa. Then he passed away. Anyway, I know everyone's looking at what a story, what a nice guy is. I wish I was in his position, but not in the bakery, in the palace. But the point is that this son of the Khalifa had everything that anyone can ask for, anything that anyone can dream for. But he didn't taste happiness until he went and lived in a bakery, until he went and started to earn his income, until he started to be a wonderful people. The point is that money doesn't bring you happiness. But what you achieve in life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what really is going to bring you happiness. Coming to the house of Allah azza wa jalla and mixing with your brothers and praying the salah in the masjid, that will bring you happiness. Attending the gathering of this gathering will bring you happiness. Reading the Quran al-Kareem will bring you contentment, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in the Quran al-Kareem, Allah bidhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub, indeed. By the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will bring contempt in your heart. What will bring contempt to your heart is the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The biggest problem that humanity and human beings in general have is that always mix money with happiness. Let's see, you've got money, you're happy. No, that's not right. What will really bring happiness to you is that you are satisfied. Self-sufficiency. Self-contentment. Be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, and see what Allah Azza wa Jalla will give you in return. Be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided to you, and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you in return. Allah will give you happiness. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who are content, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who are self-sufficient, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us what's best for us, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen to me, act upon what they listen to me. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, mashallah, la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
We are one, no mama, who should stand with each other through all the highs and lows.